Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Paul Gordon, and I am with iState.tv, and you are watching headlines you may have missed for Wednesday, January 17th, 2018. The title of this episode is While DC Burned, Americans Hashtagged Fear Porn. And we have within this show, we're going to be talking about NSA Heaven, the Internet of Things EU reg burden, Turks versus the world. There's a couple articles in a row that we're going to cover that'll explain that. Madrid's election fail and more on this episode of Headlines You May Have Missed. Now, some of you who've watched the show, you know the format of the show. We're looking at headlines that you might not necessarily see featured in a lot of other sites, even a lot of alt media sites. And that's not necessarily true. It's not a golden rule. Sometimes we put stuff in here that is being covered by the mainstream media, alt media, whatever. But it's generally the format that we try to follow. And what we do is we pick a bunch of headlines. And when I mean a bunch of headlines, if you go to isheadlines.com, you can get the archive of this. You can get the show notes for this show right now. So you can look at all the headlines that we may feature. Many of them are stuff that's on iState.tv, but there's stuff that's not on iState.tv. There are, I don't know, 50 or more headlines that are listed, and we go through and we try to see how many we can get through in the span of 20 minutes. So, without further ado, we are about ready to start the 20-minute clock. Here we go. And we're going to start the 20-minute clock now. Our first headline, U.S. Senate set to pass warrantless surveillance bill this week. So while Americans twitter away at the latest fear porn surge on their social media timeline, the Senate is preparing to quietly pass, with no real problem, the renewal of the NSA's warrantless internet surveillance program. The key operating word there being warrantless. Screw the Fourth Amendment. Let's just go with warrantless, for our safety because of terrorists and stuff. It appears as if the vote will come sometime this week, with the bill easily passing the Senate after already passing the House. So the Senate version is also missing the amendments in the House that would have held in check some aspects of the program. And when I say amendments in the House, I mean the amendments that were proposed but shot down. But let's concentrate our rage on whatever nutty thing Trump said this week, or whatever latest hashtag movement that's been created by the social justice warriors is doing at the present, whatever. So while Rome burned, America hashtagged, or alternatively, the title of this show, While DC Burned, Americans Hashtagged Fear Porn. Now we're going to get to EU looks to rein in Internet of Things with regs before it explodes. So folks, as new technologies emerge, the first thing that coercive associations ask once these technologies rise to the level where it looks like money and or free associations are forming in force, it's this. How do we regulate this? And whenever a coercive association asks this question, the ostensible reasons will always be given that they need to protect people from potential abuse by this emerging technology. But what they're really after is assuring that the technology does not allow too much independence, anonymity, self-reliance for individuals and free associations, and I might want to add, also does not offer too much competition to state-favored enterprises, and that wherever value is exchanged, the coercive association wants to make sure that it gets its cut. So this is what's going on, in a number of fronts, and we're following those. And now, the EU is tackling how to get ahead of the emerging tech of the Internet of Things. And this is from Lexology.com. So before the end of 2017, the European Union Commission published a much-anticipated communication on standard essential patents. The communication includes guidance on SEP licensing. In today's hyper-connected world, interconnectivity and interoperability of digital technologies is crucial. And with the rollout of 5G and the Internet of Things in the years to come, interconnectivity will be even more important for a wide range of new products that need to be interconnected as to provide consumers with additional products and services, blah, blah, blah. Consequently, the inclusion of a patent in a technical standard may create a monopolistic advantage for the patent holder. However, in the modern world, it is critical that technological users can quickly get access to technology protected by SEPs and that disputes and licensing negotiations between technological users and holders of SEPs do not delay the widespread use of key standardized technologies. So Lexology.com is saying, listen, man, we're for the state, we're for state control, but, you know, let's monitor the state control. Let's consider the balance between state control and allowing technology to flourish freely, but not that much, just a little bit. Now we're going to get into a series of headlines here where we get our little teaser for Turkey versus the world. This is a story that we've been following the last few days, and it is really surrounded around a region in northern Syria called Rahava, which we've talked about on numerous occasions. And if you go to iState.tv, you'll find all kinds of stuff about Rahava on iState.tv. And if you're like me and you favor tilting the balance of power towards individuals and free associations, what's going on in Rahava should matter to you. It's a grand experiment. It's not a perfect experiment. And still, for those of us that would like to see free association governance take the place of coercive association governance, what's going on in Rahava is vitally important to our understanding how that may, or for that matter, may not emerge. So on that front, let's get to Turks still preparing to invade the Rahavan enclave. The looming threat of the Turkish invasion of an enclave of Rahava appears to still be on plan as Turkish troops gather in preparation despite warnings by the U.S. and Russia to not launch this invasion. And this is from The Guardian. Turkish troops and tanks near the Syrian border are making plans to attack the U.S. military's Kurdish partners inside northern Syria. It's Rahava. As tensions between Ankara and Washington near unprecedented levels. Ahead of a widely expected incursion, the Turkish president Erdogan threatened to destroy all terror nests, a reference to Kurdish forces that the U.S. has used as proxies in the fight against Islamic State. We'll get to the next headline here, which is U.S. plans could secure Rahava against Turkish threats. So while the Turks are preparing to invade a Rahavan enclave, the U.S. is working on building a Kurdish army to effectively thwart efforts by the Turks to destroy the Kurds in Syria. And this should make for some interesting drama. Now, the Russians are opposed to the U.S. effort, but not because they don't support the Kurds. They're opposed to the Kurds being dependent on the U.S. They'd rather they depended on the Russians. And this is from the New York Times. A plan to create a new American-backed Kurdish-led border force in northeastern Syria has raised alarms in the region that the United States may be helping to cement an autonomous Kurdish enclave that could further divide the country. The 30,000-strong force, vehemently opposed by Russia, Turkey, Iran, and the Syrian government, could also ignite a new phase in the war that could pit American allies against one another and draw the United States deeper into conflict. We'll get to the next headline, which is also related to this. This is all about Turkey versus the world. Turks turn to NATO to stop U.S. arming, training Kurds. So the Turks are thinking that NATO will stop the U.S. from doing this. That's interesting. The Turkey is hoping that NATO will save them. The Turkey is hoping that NATO will save them from the U.S. and the Kurds. It's going before NATO to complain about the U.S. arming and training the Kurds for border security in northern Syria. If you gather that I don't like the Kurds, I mean, if you gather that I don't like the Turks, you're right. I don't like the Turks, specifically because of how they're threatening Rahava. Now, this is from Rudol.net, which is a, I believe, I'm pretty sure that's a pro-Turkish entity. So keep that in mind as I read this. Turkey is taking its case against the United States' formation of a border force in northern Syria to NATO. Turkey, quote, will not allow an extension of the PKK to be given support and armed under the guise of being an operational partner, unquote, Turkish Chief of General Staff General Hulusi Akar said at a NATO meeting in Brussels on Turkey. He said that fighting the PKK and the Kurdish groups in northern Syria, PYD and YPG is, quote, just as important, unquote, as fighting ISIS. Turkish President Erdogan delivered a similar message to the Secretary General of NATO, Jens Stoltenberg, telling him in a phone call on Tuesday that Turkey will not accept an SDF force in Syria and will take all necessary measures to protect its own security. And we'll get to the last story in this thread of Turkey versus the world. Russians stick by Syrian Kurds in Sochi Congress. Now, the Sochi Congress that we're talking about, this is Russia, Syria, Turkey, that have gotten together to try to figure out what to do about Syria now that the war is winding down. Ostensibly winding down. So the Russians are not backing down in their support for the Syrian Kurds in direct conflict to the desires of their allies, the Turks. And this is from, again, Rudol.net. So bear in mind, I believe this is a Turkish-leaning publication. The Sochi Congress on the Syrian conflict will bring together a more complete representation of the Syrian people, including the Kurds, and will therefore expand opportunities for resolving the conflict, Russia's foreign minister said. Russia is broadening the circle of participants, bringing in those who have been overlooked in the Geneva process. Quote, as a result of this Congress, we think that the United States nations will thank us because we will seriously expand their opportunities, expand the circle of participants so that the constitutional reform and subsequent rules for holding elections are indeed those that enjoy the support of the entire Syrian people, unquote, and not just those who have attended UN-led peace efforts in Geneva. Minister Sergei Lavrov said during a press conference in Moscow on Monday. So there you have it. That is, we're probably, who knows what we're going to find tomorrow, but I have a feeling on tomorrow's headlines you may have missed. You may have some more stories about Turkey. And do go to isheadlines.com to get the archives of all the shows where you get the videos, the audio, the Facebook video, the YouTube video, and the audio version of the show, and share this with your friends. And we'll get to the next headline. Madrid threatens to extend direct rule over Catalonia after election failure. So, after all the goose-stepping and manipulations, after all the psyops and state media propaganda, Spain's aspiring dictator, Prime Minister Mariano Rajoy, failed to manipulate the Catalan election to usher in a pro-Madrid government in Catalonia. Now, as a result of this epic failure, Rajoy is now threatening to extend Madrid's direct rule over Catalonia in a move that is likely to create more independent Catalans, not less. This is from the New York Times. So, Prime Minister Mariano Rajoy of Spain threatened on Monday to prolong the government's direct rule over Catalonia if separatist lawmakers try to allow Carles Puigdemont to run the region from exile. And we did a story about this, about him running the region through Skype, the Skype president. Mr. Rajoy ousted Puigdemont and his government. Well, I'm glad you worded it that way. Yes, that's exactly what happened. Mr. Rajoy, Madrid, ousted Puigdemont and his government in October for leading Catalonia's drive to break from Spain and called new elections. Right. And unfortunately for them, separatist parties, they won the plurality. They won 47.5% of the vote, which was sufficient to keep their parliamentary majority. And now Puigdemont appears poised to become Catalonia's leader once again. Speaking before officials of his own popular party, Mr. Rajoy described as, quote, absurd, unquote, the separatist plan to allow a, quote, fugitive to take office by video conference, by Skype, or by having another lawmaker read Mr. Puigdemont's acceptance speech on his behalf. Our next headline, China developing drone swarm army, and they're not alone. China is hard at work developing swarms of small drones with big military applications. This is from The Drive. A mass drone attack on Russia's forces in Syria has highlighted a very real danger that small unmanned aircraft increasingly pose, even in the hands of non-state groups. Well, that's a key phrase there. At the same time, it underscores how small drone swarms could be a game-changing capability for larger nation states, including the United Nations, near peer opponents, United States' near peer opponents, such as China, who are already developing this technology in a more structured environment. The drone swarms are cheap, and they cost a lot of money to defend. They raise the cost of coercion. So drone swarms, from the perspective of those who'd like to tilt the balance of power towards individuals and free associations, drone swarms could be a good thing. Our next headline, Regulation Nation throws monkey wrench at tiny homes in Cape Cod. So regulations are perhaps the greatest impediment to the ongoing experiment that is tiny home living. Cape Cod in Massachusetts is one of many places that is fighting back against the tiny home experiment with the full force and fury of Regulation Nation behind it. And this story is from the LA Times, and their title is Tiny Homes See Roadblock in Cape Cod. The state building code is where the real bump in the road is, says Victor Staley, Brewster's building inspection. But Dana Hope of Provincetown bought one anyway, tiny home, that is. She hopes her commitment to her tiny property becomes the impetus for Provincetown to figure out how to permit these places that would affordably allow Cape Codders to own a home. Tiny homes, they're fascinating. I don't know how much you know about tiny homes, but they're, you know, some of them are like 200 square feet or sometimes less, sometimes a little more. But there's, you've heard of the minimalist movement where you try to minimalize the amount of stuff that you have in your life. Well, tiny homes is a part of that for people that want to minimalize their obligation, if you will. Tiny homes are much less expensive than full-size homes. And then there's a lot of great areas as far as, well, how do you get the property tax on tiny homes, other issues. But they afford individuals the opportunity. It's one opportunity to be able to reduce your monetary imprint, and a lot of these folks that do tiny homes, they're doing it from the perspective of they want to save the world. They want to reduce their pollution imprint. And I mean, I'm not against reducing your pollution imprint, but I'm much more interested in reducing that monetary imprint, in reducing your dependence on the coercive associations around you. And tiny homes, they're one of the possible solutions there. And don't you think that at some level, the highest level of deep thinkers within the coercive association are fully aware of exactly what kind of threat tiny homes pose to their empire of coercion. So I'll continue here. Tiny homes are a win-win, Hope said. I want to be able to afford my life, to go out to dinner, and to have just one job. Right. To reduce the... Yeah, yes. If you reduce your monetary imprint, then one of the benefits is maybe you don't have to work as long hours, or maybe you only have to work one job. You have more time to work on yourself, if you will. Whatever that might be, an independent study, or maybe you just want to go fishing. Whatever it is, you have more time in which you're actually working on developing yourself and not simply grinding. Not that all work is grinding. Some people, for me, for instance, the work that I do, it's not grinding. It's a mutual thing. I am actually working on myself while I work, but that's beside the point. But last week, the Provincetown Board of Selectmen ruled that tiny homes on wheels are unrealistic. Tiny homes which are on wheels and not connected to sewers, blah, blah, blah. They're not going to happen. I'm a realist. If Nantucket passed a law and they can't do it, then how can we? So basically what you're saying, you know, it's my laws and, you know, people are not living the way civilized people live. Well, then I've got a problem with that. So there you go. Well, we have one more headline, which we have time to get to. World Bank accused of numbers manipulation to hurt Chile in report. Is the World Bank ginning up or down the numbers to get the desired results they want in their doing business rankings? Chile is accusing the World Bank of doing just that. Boy, what a surprise. I can't believe the World Bank would do something like that. So this is from bnamericas.com. The news that the World Bank made repeated methodology modifications over the past 4 years to its doing business rankings, changes that penalized Chile more than any other nation, is worrisome because it places into question the credibility. You should have thought about it a long time ago, credibility of the World Bank, credibility of the information provided by the Bretton Woods Institution. At BN America, we rely on these competitiveness rankings to bolster our news. They provide a framework of understanding to our reporting on the real economy within Latin America and influence our macro analysis of countries. Chile is currently 55 of 190 countries on the list, down from 34 in 2014 when President Michelle Bachelet began her second term. So let's get to, real quick, let's get to, just read, these are some of the headlines that we didn't get to. AI can customize your Medicare by detecting age of your cells. Net neutrality restoration bill has 49 votes and counting in the Senate. West Virginia bill would make Bible studies mandatory in schools. NAFTA is not dead, says Trump. New peptide promises effective treatment of many cancers. 3D bioprinted tracheas and rats done with no scaffold. U.S. set to become net exporter of natural gas. Again, World Bank urges Russia to spend more on healthcare, education. Scientists create miniature gamma ray bursts to study black holes. Twitter tried to curb abuse. Now it has to handle the backlash. And finally, East Tennessee prepper Hawaii false alert should serve as wake-up call. There you go. So those are the headlines. And if you're watching on YouTube, we're about ready to end. I want to make sure that you go to isheadlines.com where you can read in more detail the headlines that we covered. And you can also find a whole bunch of links. If you look here, this thing goes down quite a while. A lot of other stories on here for you to go through. What are the headlines that that are not being shared in a lot of other sites? Be sure that you subscribe to our YouTube channel here at youtube.com. Actually, you can subscribe. If you just go to u.istate.tv, it'll take you to our YouTube channel, and you can subscribe and hit the notification as well. And for our YouTube audience, we'll say goodbye. If you want to make sure that you watch the full version of the show, then you're going to want to go to look me up, Paul Gordon. My image is going to be the same as what you see in the show here. And as long as your Facebook page doesn't show some Nutterburger way out there stuff, and I'll be the arbiter of that, I will friend request you back, and you can watch the show on Facebook. So for our YouTube audience, let me say this is Paul Gordon of iState.tv. You have been watching headlines you may have missed for Wednesday, January 17th, 2018.